Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, one and all, to William Shakespeare's The Taming of the Shrew, a radio play.
Hey, Zachary, honey, can you come downstairs?
Mom, I'm recording something for class, please. Thank you. Thank you. Where was I? Presented by the BFA Acting Class of 2021. The cast is as follows. Gabby Pesapia as Bianca and Grumio. McLean Bolden as Katerina and Servant. Patrick O'Day as Lucentio, Taylor, and Curtis. Alex Grimm as Grinio, Biondello, Joseph, and Pedant. Tyra Medina as Baptista, Nicholas, and Haberdasher. Atreves McCullough as Hortensio, Vincenzo, and Nathaniel. Leonardo Elian as Tronio, Philip, and Widow. And Zachary Moore as Petruchio and narrator. Thank you and enjoy. Act 1, Scene 1. Padua, a public place. Enter a young scholar named Lucentio and his man Tronio.
Tronio, since for the great desire I had to see fair Padua, nursery of arts, I am arrived for fruitful Italy. Here, let us breathe and happily institute a course of learning and ingenious studies.
Mi perdonato, gentle master mine.
Let's be no stoics or no stocks, I pray. No profit grows where no pleasure taken.
Gramercy's Tranio, well dost thou advise. But stay a while. Oh, what company is this?
Enter Signora Baptista, her two daughters, Katerina and Bianca, and two suitors, Grimio and Hortensio. Lucentio and Tranio stand off and away.
Gentlemen, importune me no farther, for how I firmly am resolved, you know. That is not bestow my youngest daughter before I have a husband for the elder. But if either of you both love Katerina, shall leave her to court her at your pleasure.
To cart her, rather. She's too rough for me.
I pray you, ma'am, is it your will to make a stale of me amongst these mates?
Mates, maid? How mean you that? No mates for you unless you were of gentler, milder mold.
I'faith, sir, you shall never need to fear. I wis it is not halfway to her heart, but if it were, doubt not her care should be to comb your noddle with a three-legged stool and paint your face and use you like a fool.
Ugh! From all such devils, good Lord, deliver us.
Ah, oh, and me too, good Lord.
Gentlemen, that I may soon make good what I have said, Bianca, get you in and let it not displease thee, good Bianca.
A pretty Pete. It is best put a finger in the eye, and she knew why.
Sister, content you in my discontent. Ma'am, I am to your pleasure, humbly I subscribe. My books and instruments shall be my company, on them and took in practice by myself.
Sorry am I that our good will affect Bianca's grief.
Oh, why will you mew her up, Signora Baptista, for this fiend of hell, and make her bear the penance of her tongue?
Gentlemen, content ye, I am resolved. Go in, Bianca, and for I know she taketh most delight in music, instruments, and poetry. Schoolmasters will I keep within my house. And so farewell. Katerina, you may stay.
Why? And I trust I may go too, may I not?
Oh, you may go to the devil's dam. Here's none will hold you. Yet for the love I bear my sweet Bianca, if I can by any means light on a fit man to teach her that wherein she delights, I will wish him to her mother.
So will I, Signor Grimio. But a word, I pray. Know now, upon advice, that we may yet again have access to our fair mistress, and be rivals in Bianca's love, to labor and effect one thing specially, to get a husband for her sister.
Thinkest thou, Hortensio, though her mother be very rich, any man is so very a fool to be married to hell?
Tush, why, man, there be good fellows in the world, and would take her with all faults and money enough. Since this bear-in-law makes us friends, it shall be so far forth friendly maintained by helping Baptista's eldest daughter to a husband, we set her youngest free for a husband. How say you, Senor Grimio?
I am agreed. Come on.
We emerge Tronio and Lucentio.
Ooh, I pray, sir, tell me. Is it possible that love should of a sudden take such hold?
I never thought it possible or likely, but see, I burn, I pine, I perish, Tronio, if I achieve not this young, modest girl.
Her eldest sister is so cursed and shrewd that till the father rid her hands of her master, your love must live a maid at home.
But art thou not advised? He took some care to get her cunning schoolmasters to instruct her.
Aye, and 'tis plotted. You will be schoolmaster and undertake the teaching of the maid.
Thou shalt be master, Tronio, in my stead. Uncase thee, take my colored hat and cloak.
Oh, for so your father charged me at our parting. Be serviceable to my son, quoth he. I am content to be Lucentio.
And let me be a slave to achieve that maid whose sudden sight hath thralled my wounded eye.
Enter the servant Biondello.
Sirrah, where have you been?
Where have I been? Nay, how now, where are you? Master, has my fellow Tranio stolen your clothes?
Your fellow Tranio here, to save my life, puts my apparel and my countenance on. Wait you on him, I charge you, and not a jot of Tranio in your mouth. Tranio is changed into Lucentio.
The better for him. Would I were so too.
Act 1, Scene 2. Padua, before Hortensio's house. Enter a wealthy landowner, Petruchio, and his man, Gumio.
Verona, for a while I take my leave, to see my friend in Padua, Hortensio. Here, Sierra Grimio, knock, I say.
Knock, sir? Whom should I knock?
Villain, I say knock me here soundly.
Knock you here, sir? What am I, sir, that I should knock you here, sir?
Villain, I say knock me at this gate.
My master has grown quarrelsome. I should knock you first. Help! Help! Oh, my master is mad.
Now knock when I bid you, Sirrah.
How now? My old friend Grumio and my good friend Petruchio.
Signor Hortensio, come you to part the fray? I bade the rascal knock upon your gate and could not get him from my heart to do it.
Knock at the gate? Oh, heavens.
Sirrah, be gone, or talk not. I advise you.
Petruchio, patience. I am Grumio's pledge. And tell me now, sweet friend, what happy gale blows you to Padua here from old Verona?
I have thrust myself into this maze happily to wive and thrive as best I may.
Petruchio, shall I then come roundly to thee and wish thee to a shrewd, ill-favored wife? Thou'st thanked me but a little for my counsel, and yet I'll promise thee she shall be rich.
Signor Hortensio, oh, if thou know one rich enough to be Petruchio's wife, be she as foul as Florentius's love, I come to wive it wealthily in Padua.
I can, Petruchio, help thee to a wife with wealth enough and young and beauteous. Her only fault, and that is fault enough, is that she is intolerable, cursed and shrewd and froward, so beyond all measure, I would not wed her for a mine of gold.
Tell me her mother's name, and 'tis enough, for I will board her, though she chide as loud as thunder when the clouds in autumn crack.
Her mother is Baptista Manola. Her name is Caterina Manola, renowned in Padua for her scolding tongue.
I know her mother, though I know not her, and she knew my deceased father well. I will not sleep, Hortensio, till I see her.
I pray you, sir, let him go while the humor lasts.
Tarry, Petruchio, I must go with thee, for in Baptista's keep my treasure is her youngest daughter, beautiful Bianca, and none shall have access unto Bianca till Caterina the Cursed have got a husband.
Caterina the Cursed.
Now shall my friend Petruchio do me grace and offer me disguised in sober robes to old Baptista as a schoolmaster, well seen in music, to instruct Bianca, that so I may, by this device, at least have leave and leisure to make love to her.
Enter Grimio and Lucentio, disguised as a scholar.
Psst! Master! Master! Look about you! Who goes there, huh?
Be peace, Grumio. It is the rival of my love.
Hark you, sir, I'll have them very fairly bound. All books of love. See that at any hand, and see you read no other lectures to her, you understand me? Then what will you read to her?
Whate'er I read to her, I'll plead for you as my patron. Stand you so assured.
God save you, Signor Grimio.
Oh, and you are well met, Signor Hortensio. Trow you whither I am going? To Baptista Minola. I promised to inquire carefully about a schoolmaster for the fair Bianca, and by good fortune I have lighted well on this young man, for learning and behavior.
Just well. And I have met a gentleman, a fine musician, to instruct our mistress. So shall I no whit be behind in duty to fair Bianca, so beloved of me.
Beloved of me?
Grimio, 'tis now no time to vent our love. Here is a gentleman whom by chance I met, upon agreement from us to his liking, will undertake to woo cursed Caterina.
Hortensio, have you told him all her faults?
I know she is an irksome brawling scold. If that be all, masters, I hear no harm.
Oh, if you have a stomach to it, in God's name. But will you woo this wildcat?
Have I not in my time heard lions roar? And do you tell me of a woman's tongue?
This gentleman is happily arrived, my mind presumes, for his own good and ours.
I promised we would be contributors and bear his charge of wooing whatsoever.
And so we will, provided that he win her.
Enter Tronio, disguised as Lucentio.
Gentlemen, God save you. I beseech you. Which is the readiest way to the house of Signora Baptista Minola, she that hath two fair daughters?
Not her that chides, sir, at any hand, I pray.
I love no chider, sir.
Are you a suitor to the maid you talk of? Yea or no?
And if I be, sir, is it any offense?
No, if without more words you will get you hence.
Why, sir, I pray, are these streets not as free?
But so is not she.
For what reason? I beseech you.
Well, for this reason, if you'll know, that she's the choice love of Signor Grimio.
That she's the chosen of Signor Hortensio.
Softly, my masters. Hear me with patience. Baptista is a noble gentlewoman, and were her daughters fairer than she is, she may more suitors have, and me for one.
Sir, let me be so bold as ask you. Did you yet ever see Baptista's daughter?
No, sir. But here I do that she hath two. The one as famous for a scolding tongue as is the other for beauteous modesty.
Sir, the first for me. Let her go by. The youngest daughter, whom you hearken for, her mother keeps from all access of suitors, and will not promise her to any man until the elder sister first be wed.
If it be so, sir, that you are the man, must stead us all and me amongst the rest.
You must, as we do, gratify this gentleman, to whom we all rest generally beholding.
Please, yea, we may contrive this afternoon, strive mightily, but eat and drink as friends.
End of Act One.
Act Two, Scene One. Padua, a room in Baptista's house. Enter Caterina and Bianca.
Ugh! Good sister, wrong me not, nor wrong yourself. Unbind my hands.
Of all thy suitors, here I charge thee. Tell whom thou lovest best. See thou dissemble not.
Believe me, sister, of all the men alive, I never yet beheld that special face which I could fancy more than any other.
Minion, thou liest! Is it not Hortensio?
Ooh, if you affect him here, I swear I'll plead for you myself, but you shall have him.
Oh, then, belike, you fancy riches more. You will have Grimio to keep you fair.
Is it for him you do envy me so? You have but jested with me all this while. I prithee, Sister Kate, untie my hands.
If that be just, then all the rest was so.
Why, how now, dame? Whence grows this insolence? Bianca, stand aside. Poor girl, she weeps. Why dost thou wrong her that ne'er wronged thee?
Her silence flouts me, and I'll be revenged.
What? In my sight? Bianca, get thee in.
What, will you not suffer me? Nay, now I see she is your treasure. She must have a husband. Talk not to me. I will go sit and weep till I can find occasion of revenge.
Oh, was ever a noble woman thus grieved as I?
Enter Grimio, with disguised scholar Lucentio, as well as Petruchio, with disguised musician Hortensio, and Tronio, dressed as his master Lucentio.
Good morrow, neighbor Baptista.
Good morrow, Grimio. God save you, gentlemen.
And you, good madam. Pray, have you not a daughter called Caterina, fair and virtuous?
I have a daughter, sir, called Caterina.
I am a gentleman of Verona, ma'am, that hearing of her beauty and her wit, I am bold to show myself a forward guest within your house to make mine eye the witness of that report which I so oft have heard. I do present you with a man of mine, cunning in music and the mathematics, to instruct her fully in those sciences. His name is Licio, born in Mantua.
You're welcome, sir, and he for your sake. But for my daughter Caterina, this I know, she is not for your turn, the more my grief.
I see you do not mean to part with her, or else you like not of my company.
Mistake me not. I speak but as I find. Whence are you, sir? What may I call your name?
Petruchio is my name, Antonio's son, a man well known throughout all Italy.
Ah, I know him well. You are welcome for his sake.
Neighbor, this is a gift to express the like kindness myself freely give unto you this young scholar. As cunning in Greek, Latin, and other languages, his name is Cambio. Pray, accept his service.
1,000 thanks, Signor Grimio. Welcome, good Cambio. But gentle sir, methinks you walk like a stranger. May I be so bold to know what the cause of your coming?
Pardon me, ma'am. The boldness is mine own, that being a stranger in this city here, do make myself a suitor to your daughter. Unto Bianca, fair and virtuous. That upon knowledge of my parentage, I may have welcome amongst the rest that woo.
Lucentio is your name. Of whence, I pray?
Of Pisa, ma'am. Son to Vincentio.
I know him well. You are very welcome, sir. Hallo within! Sirrah, lead these gentlemen to my daughters, and tell them both these are their tutors. Bid them use them well.
Exit servant, with disguised Lucentio and Hortensio.
Signor Baptista, my business asketh haste. You knew my father well, and in him me, left solely heir to all his lands and goods, which I have bettered rather than decreased. Then tell me, if I get your daughter's love, what dowry shall I have with her to wife?
After my death, the one half of my lands and in possession, 20,000 crowns.
And for that dowry, I'll assure her of her widowhood, be it that she survives me. Let specialties be therefore drawn between us.
Aye, when the special thing is well obtained, that is, her love, for that is all in all.
I am as peremptory as she proud-minded, and where two raging fires meet together, they do consume the thing that feeds their fury. So I to her, and so she yields to me.
Way mayst thou woo, and happy be thy speed.
Re-enter Hortensio, with his lute broken over his head.
How now, my friend? Why dost thou look so pale? What, will my daughter prove a good musician?
Why, no, for she hath broke the lute to me. I did but tell her she must stop her frets, and with that word she struck me on the head while she did call me rascal fiddler.
Down by the world, it is a lusty wench. I love her 10 times more than e'er I did. Oh, how I long to have some chat with her.
Proceed in practice with my younger daughter. She's apt to learn and thankful for good turns. Signor Petruchio, will you go with us? Or shall I send my daughter Kate to you?
Oh, I pray you do. I will attend her here, and woo her with some spirit when she comes. Say that she wail. Why then, I'll tell her plain, she sings as sweetly as a nightingale. Say she be mute, and will not speak a word, then I'll commend her volubility. And say she uttereth piercing eloquence. If she do bid me pack, I'll give her thanks. If she deny to wed, I'll crave the day when I shall ask the banns and when be married. Oh, but here she comes. And now, Petruchio, speak. Good morrow, Kate. for that's your name, I hear.
Well, have you heard, but something hard of hearing? They call me Katerina that do talk of me.
You lie in faith, for you are called plain Kate, and Bonnie Kate, and sometimes Kate the Cursed. But Kate, the prettiest Kate in Christendom, hearing thy mildness praised in every town, myself am moved to woo thee for my wife.
Moved? In good time. Let him that moved you hither remove you hence. I knew you at the first. You were immovable.
Oh, thou hast hint. Come, sit on me.
Asses are made to bear, and so are you.
Women are made to bear, and so are you.
No such jade as you, if me you mean.
Come, come, you wasp. If faith, you are too angry.
If I be waspish, best beware my sting.
My remedy is, then, to pluck it out.
Aye, if the fool could find it where it lies.
Oh, who knows not where a wasp does wear his sting? In his tail?
In his tongue.
Whose tongue?
Yours, if you talk of tails, and so, farewell.
What, with my tongue in your tail?
Ugh.
Nay, come again, good Kate. I am a gentleman.
That I'll try.
I swear, I'll cuff you if you strike again.
So may you lose your arms. If you strike me, you are no gentleman. And if no gentleman, why then no arms.
Nay, come, Kate, come. You must not look so sour.
It is my fashion when I see a crab.
Now, by St. George, I am too young for you.
Yet, you are withered.
Tis with cares.
I care not.
Nay, hear you, Kate. In sooth, you scape not so.
I chafe you if I tarry. Let me go.
No, not a whit. I find you passing gentle. 'Twas told me you were rough and coy and sullen. And now I find your report a very liar. For thou art pleasant, gamesome, but slow in speech. Thou canst not frown, thou canst not look askance, but thou with mildness entertain'st thy wooers.
Go, fool, and whom thou keep'st command.
Am I not wise?
Yes, keep you warm.
Marry, so I mean, sweet Katerina, in thy bed. Thus, in plain terms, your father hath consented that you shall be my wife. Your dowry agreed on, and will you, know you, I will marry you. Now, Kate, I'm a husband for your turn. For by this light whereby I see thy beauty, thou must be married to no man but me. For I am he, and born to tame you, Kate. I must and will have Katerina to my wife.
Re-enter Baptista, Grimio, and Tranio.
Now, Signor Petruchio, how speedy with my daughter?
Call you me daughter? Now I promise you, you have showed a tender motherly regard to wish me to wed one half lunatic.
Mother, 'tis thus yourself and all the world that talked of her have talked amiss of her. If she be cursed, it is for policy. For she's not froward, but modest as the dove. She is not hot, but temperate as the morn. And to conclude, we have agreed so well together that upon Sunday is the wedding day.
I'll see thee hanged on Sunday first.
Hark, Petruchio, she says she'll see thee hanged first.
Is this your speeding? Nay, then good night our part.
'Tis bargain twixt us twain, being alone, that she shall still be cursed in company. Now I tell you, 'tis incredible to believe how much she loves me. Oh, the kindest Kate. She hung about my neck, and kiss on kiss, she vied so fast, protesting oath on oath, that in a twink she won me to her love. Give me thy hand, Kate. Provide the feast, mother, and bid the guests.
I know not what to say, but give me your hands. God send you joy, Petruchio, 'tis a match.
Oh, mother, and wife, and gentlemen, adieu! I will to Venice. Sunday comes apace. And kiss me, Kate. We will be married o' Sunday.
Exit Petruchio and Katerina severally.
Was ever match clapped up so suddenly? But now, Baptista, to your youngest daughter, now is the day we long have looked for. I am your neighbor, and was suitor first.
And I am one that loved Bianca more than words can witness, or your thoughts can guess.
Tis deeds must win the prize. And he of both that can assure my daughter, greatest dower, shall have my Bianca's love. Say, Signor Grimio, what can you assure her?
First, as you know, my house within the city is richly furnished with plate and gold, costly apparel, and all things that belong to house or housekeeping. Then at my farm, a 60 fat oxen standing in my stalls, and if I die tomorrow, this is hers. If whilst I live, she will be only mine.
That only came well in. Ma'am, list to me. I am my father's heir and only son. If I may have your daughter to my wife, I'll leave her houses 3 or 4 as good within rich Pisa walls as any one old Signor Grimio has in Padua. Besides, 2,000 ducats by the year of fruitful land, all which shall be her jointer.
2,000 ducats by the year of land? My land amounts not to so much at all. Nay, I have offered all. I have no more.
Why, then, the maid is mine from all the world, by your firm promise. Grimio is outvied.
I must confess, your offer is the best. And let your father make her the assurance she is your own. Well, gentlemen, I am thus resolved. On Sunday next, you know my daughter, Katharina, is to be married. Now, on the Sunday following, shall Bianca be bride to you, if you make this assurance. And so, I take my leave, and thank you both.
Sirrah, young gamester, your father were a fool to give thee all, and in his waning age. An old Italian fox is not so kind, my boy.
Exit Grimio, leaving Tranio alone.
'Tis in my head to do my master good. I see no reason, but supposed Lucentio must get a father called supposed Vincentio.
End of Act 2. Act 3. Scene 1. Padua. Baptista's house. Enter Lucentio, Hortensio, and Bianca.
Fiddler, forbear. You grow too forward, sir. Have you so soon forgot the entertainment her sister Katerina welcomed you withal?
Then give me leave to have prerogative, and when in music we have spent an hour, your lecture shall have leisure for as much.
Far to know the cause why music was ordained. Was it not to refresh the mind of man after his studies or his usual pain? Then give me leave to read philosophy, and while I pause, serve in your harmony.
Sirrah, I will not bear these braids of thine.
Why, gentlemen, you do me double wrong to strive for that which resteth in my choice. I'll be not tied to hours nor pointed times, but learn my lessons as I please myself. And to cut off all strife, here sit we down. Take you your instrument, and play you the whiles. His lecture will be done ere we have tuned.
You'll leave his lecture when I am in tune?
That will be never. Tune your instrument.
Where left we last?
Here, madam. Hic ibat, as I told you before. Simois, I am Lucentio. Hic est, son unto Vincentio of Pisa. Sigia talus, disguised thus to get your love. Hic stederat, and the Lucentio that comes a-wooing, Priami, is my man Tranio. Regia, bearing my port. Celsia senis, that we might beguile the old pantaloon.
Madam, my instrument's in tune.
Let's hear. Oh, fie, the treble jars.
Spit in the hole, man, and tune again.
Now, let me see if I can conster it. Hic ibat simois, I know you not. Hic est sigia talus, I trust you not. Hic stederat Priami, take heed he hear us not. Regia, presume not. Celsus anis, despair not.
Madam, 'tis now in tune.
All but the bass.
The bass is right. 'Tis the babe knave that jars. Now, for my life, the knave doth court my love.
In time I may believe, yet I mistrust. Now let it rest. Now to you, Litio. Good masters, take it not unkindly, pray, that I have thus been pleasant with you both.
You may go walk, and give me leave a while. My lessons make no music in three parts.
Well, I must wait and watch with all four, but I be deceived our fine musician groweth amorous.
Madam, before you touch the instrument, to learn the order of my fingering, I must begin with rudiments of art, to teach you gamut in a briefer sort than half been taught by any of my trade.
Why, I am past my gamut long ago.
Yet read the gamut of Hortensio.
Gamut I am, the ground of all accord. A. Re, to plead Hortensio's passion. B. Me, Bianca, take him for thy lord. C. Fa ut, that loves with all affection. Call you this gamut? Tut, I like it not.
Enter a servant.
Mistress, your mother prays you leave your books and help to dress your sister's chamber up. You know tomorrow is the wedding day.
Farewell, sweet masters both, I must be gone.
Faith, mistress, then I have no cause to stay.
But I have cause to pry into this pedant. But thinks he looks as though he were in love. Yet if thy thoughts, Bianca, be so humble, cease thee that list. If once I find thee ranging, Hortensio will be quit with thee by changing.
Act 3, Scene 2, Padua, before Baptista's house. Enter Baptista, Tronio, Caterina, Bianca, Lucentio, and others, attendants.
Signor Lucentio, this is the appointed day, that Caterina and Petruchio should be married, and yet we hear not of our son-in-law. What says Lucentio to this shame of ours?
No shame but mine. I must forsooth be forced to give my hand opposed against my heart unto a mad brain, rudes be full of spleen, who wooed in haste and means to wed at leisure. He'll woo 1,000 point the day of marriage, make feasts, invite friends, and proclaim the banns, yet never means to wed where he hath wooed. Now must the world point at poor Caterina and say, lo, there is mad Petruchio's wife. If it would please him, come and marry her.
Upon my life, Petruchio means but well. Whatever fortune stays him from his word, though he be blunt, I know him passing wise.
Would Caterina had never seen him, though.
Girl, go. I cannot blame thee now to weep, for such an injury would vex of every saint.
Master, master, news, old news, and such news as you never heard of. He is coming.
When will he be here?
When he stands where I am and sees you there.
But say, what thine old news?
Why, Petruchio is coming in a new hat and an old jerkin, a pair of old breeches thrice turned, a pair of boots, one buckled, another laced, his horse hipped with an old mothy saddle.
Who comes with him?
Oh, sir, his lackey, for all the world comparison like the horse.
I'm glad he's come, howsoe'er he comes.
Why, sir, he comes not.
Didst thou not say he comes?
No, sir, I say his horse comes, with him on his back.
Why, that's all one.
Ugh, come, where be these gallants?
You are welcome, sir.
And yet I come not well.
Not so well apparelled as I wish you were.
Gentles, methinks you frown, as if you saw some wondrous monument.
Why, sir, you know this is your wedding day.
And tell us, what occasion of import hath all so long detained you from your wife, and sent you hither so unlike yourself?
Oh, suffice it. I am come to keep my word, though in some part enforced to digress, which, at more leisure, I will so excuse. But where is Kate? 'Tis time we are at church.
Oh, see not your bride in these unreverent robes. Go to my chamber. Put on clothes of mine.
Not I, believe me. Thus I'll visit her.
But thus I trust you will not marry her.
To me she's married. Not unto my clothes. But what a fool am I to chat with you when I should bid good morrow to my bride and seal the title with a lovely kiss.
Exit Petruchio and Grumio.
He hath some meaning in his mad attire. We will persuade him, be it possible, to put on better ere he go to church.
I'll after him and see the event of this.
As I before unparted to your worship, I am to get a man. We'll fit him in our turn, and he shall be Vincenzio of Pisa, and make assurance here in Padua of greater sums than I have promised. So shall you quietly enjoy your hope and marry sweet Bianca with consent.
Doth watch Bianca's steps so narrowly. 'Twere good, methinks, to steal our marriage.
Signor Grimio, came you from the church?
As willingly as e'er I came from school.
And is the bride and bridegroom coming home?
A bridegroom, say you? 'Tis a grumbling groom.
Cursed her that she? Why, 'tis impossible. She's a devil.
Tut, she's a lamb, a dove, a fool to him. I'll tell you, Sir Lucentio, when the priest should ask if Caterina should be his wife, "Aye, by God's wounds," quoth he, and swore so loud that all amazed the priest let fall the book. And as he stooped again to take it up, the mad-brained bridegroom took him such a cuff that down fell priest and book and priest.
What said the wench when he rose again?
Trembled and shook, for why he stamped and swore and calls for wine, a help, quoth he. This done, he took the bride about the neck and kissed her lips with such a clamorous smack that at the parting all the church did echo. Such a mad marriage never was before.
Re-enter Petruchio, Caterina, Bianca, Baptista, and Hortensio.
Gentlemen and friends, I thank you for your pains. I know you think to dine with me today, but so it is. My haste hath called me hence, and therefore here I mean to take my leave.
Is it possible you will away tonight?
I must away today. I thank you all that have beheld me give away myself to this most patient, sweet, and virtuous wife. Dine with my father, drink a health to me.
Let us entreat you stay, till after dinner.
It may not be.
Let me entreat you.
It cannot be.
Let me entreat you.
I am content.
Are you content to stay?
I am content you shall entreat me stay, but yet not stay. Entreat me how you can.
Now if you love me, stay.
Grimio, my horse!
Do it thou canst, I will not go today. No, nor tomorrow. Not till I please myself. The door is open, sir. There lies your way. For me, I'll not be gone till I please myself.
Oh, Kate, content thee. Prithee, be not angry.
I will be angry. What hast thou to do? Gentlemen, forward to the bridal dinner. I see a woman may be made a fool if she had not a spirit to resist.
They shall go forward, Kate, at thy command. Go to the feast, revel, and domineer. But for my bonnie Kate, she must with me. I will be master of what is mine own, and here she stands. Touch her, whoever dare. I'll bring mine action on the proudest he. Draw forth my weapon, rescue my mistress. Oh, fear not, sweet wench. They shall not touch thee, Kate.
Exit Petruchio, Caterina, and Grumio.
Nay, let them go. A couple of quiet ones.
Of all mad matches, never was the like.
Mistress, what's your opinion of your sister?
That being mad herself, she's madly mated. I warrant him, Petruchio is cated.
Neighbors and friends, though bride and bridegroom wants for to supply the places at the table, you know they want no junkets at the feast. Lucentio, you shall supply the bridegroom's place and let Bianca take her sister's room.
Shall sweet Bianca practice how to bride it?
She shall, Lucentio. Come, gentlemen, let's go.
End of Act 3. Siamo noi, il poeta, l'assassino, sua santità. Act 4, Scene 1, Petruchio's country house. Enter Grumio.
Fie on all tired jades, on all mad masters. Was ever a man so beaten? I am sent before to make a fire, and they are coming to warm them. Holla ho, Curtis!
Who is that called so coldly?
A piece of ice. A fire, good Curtis.
Is my master and his wife coming, good Grumio?
Oh, aye, Curtis, aye. And therefore, fire, fire!
Is she so hot a shrew as she's reported?
She was, good Curtis, before this frost. But thou knowest winter tames man, woman, and beast. Why, therefore, fire, for I have caught an extreme cold. Where's the cook? Is supper ready, the house trimmed, and every officer his wedding garment on?
All ready, and therefore, I pray thee news?
First, my horse is tired. My mistress and my master fallen out.
How?
Out of their saddles and into the dirt, and thereby hangs a tale.
Let's have it, good Grumio.
We came down a hill. My master riding behind my mistress. Her horse fell, and she under the horse. Thou shouldest hear how he left her with the horse upon her, how he beat me because her horse stumbled, and how she waded through the dirt to pluck him off of me, how he swore, how she prayed, how I cried, and how the horses ran away.
By this reckoning, he is more shrew than she.
Aye, and that thou and the proudest of all shall find when he comes home. Call forth Nathaniel, Joseph, Philip, Nicholas, and the rest. Are they all ready?
Ho! Welcome home, Grumio!
What, Grumio?
Fellow Grumio!
Now, my spruce companions, is all things ready and all things neat?
All things is ready. How near is our master?
Even at hand. Cock's passion, silence! I hear my master!
Where be these knaves? What? No man at door? Where is Nathaniel? Gregory? Philip?
Here, sir.
And where is the foolish knave I sent before?
Here, sir. As foolish as I was before.
Did I not bid thee meet me in the park?
Yes, as they are, here they come to meet you.
Go, rascals, go and fetch my supper in. Where is the life that late I led? Where are the... Oh, sit down, Kate, and welcome. Why, when I say, nay, good sweet Kate, be merry. Off with my boots! You rogues, you villains, when?
Patience, I pray you. 'Twas a fault unwilling.
A whoreson, beetlehead, flap-eared knave! Oh, come, Kate, sit down. I know you have a stomach. What's this? Mutton?
Aye.
Who brought it?
Aye.
'Tis burnt, and so is all the meat. There, take it, you, trenchers, cups, and all.
I pray you, husband, be not so disquiet. The meat was well if you were so contented.
Oh, I tell thee, Kate, 'twas burnt and dried away, and I expressly am forbid to touch it. Be patient. Tomorrow it shall be mended. And for this night, we'll fast for company. Come, I will bring thee to thy bridal chamber.
Peter, didst ever see the like?
He kills her in her own humor.
Where is he?
In her chamber, making a sermon of continency to her, and rails and swears and rates that she, poor soul, knows not which way to stand, to look, to speak. Away, away, for he is coming hither.
Thus have I politically begun my reign. My falcon now is sharp and passing empty. Until she stoop, she must not be full gorged. For then she never looks upon her lure. She eat no meat today, nor none shall eat. Last night she slept not, nor tonight she shall not. As with the meat, some undeserved fault I'll find about the making of the bed. Aye, and amid this hurly I intend that all is done in reverend care of her. And if she chance to nod, I'll rail and brawl, and with the clamor keep her still awake. And thus I'll curb her mad and headstrong humor. He that knows better how to tame a shrew. Now, let him speak.
Act 4, Scene 2. Padua, before Baptista's house. Enter Tranio as Lucentio, and Hortensio as Licio.
Is it possible, friend Licio, that Mistress Bianca doth fancy any other but Lucentio?
Sir, to satisfy you in what I have said, stand by and mark the manner of his teaching.
They hide and listen, while Bianca and Lucentio enter.
Now, mistress, profit you in what you read?
What master read you? First resolve me that.
I read that I profess the art of love.
And may you prove master of your art.
While you, sweet dear, prove mistress of my heart.
They exit, while Tranio and Hortensio come forward.
Quick, proceeders, marry. Now, tell me, I pray, You that dare swear at your mistress, Bianca, love none in the world so well as Lucentio.
Oh, inconstant womankind! I tell thee, Licio, this is wonderful.
Mistake no more. I am not Licio, nor a musician as I seem to be, but one that scorned to live in this disguise. No, sir, that I am called Hortensio.
Signor Hortensio, I have often heard of your entire affection to Bianca. I will with you if you be so contented, forswear Bianca and her love forever.
See how they kiss in court. Signor Lucentio, here is my hand, and here I firmly vow never to woo her more, but do forswear her.
And here I take the unfeigned oath, never to marry with her. Fie on her.
I will be married to a wealthy widow ere 3 days pass, which hath as long loved me as I have loved this proud, disdainful haggard. And so, farewell, Signor Lucentio.
Mistress Bianca, bless you with such grace as longeth to a lover's blessed case. Nay, I have taken you napping, gentle love, and have forsworn you with Hortensio.
Tranio, you jest, but have you both forsworn me?
Mistress, we have.
Then we are rid of Licio.
I faith he'll have a lusty widow now.
God give him joy.
Aye, and he'll tame her. Faith, he has gone unto the taming school.
The taming school? What, is there such a place?
Aye, mistress, and Petruchio is the master, to tame a shrew and charm her chattering tongue.
Oh, master, master, I at last have spied an ancient angel who will serve the turn.
Who is he, Biondello?
Master, a pedant, but formal in apparel, in gait and countenance, surely like a father.
And what of him, Tranio?
If he be so credulous and trust my tale, I'll make him glad to seem Vincenzio, and give him assurance to Baptista Minola. Take in your love, and let me alone.
Enter a pedant.
God save you, sir.
And you, sir! You are welcome. Travel you far on? What countryman, I pray?
Of Mantua.
And come to Padua, careless of your life.
My life, sir? How, I pray?
Oh, 'tis death for anyone in Mantua to come to Padua. Know you not the Duke hath proclaimed it openly?
Alas, sir, it is worse for me than so, for I have bills for money by exchange from Florence, and must here deliver them.
Well, sir, to do you courtesy, this will I do, and this I will advise you. First, tell me, have you ever been at Pisa?
Aye, sir, in Pisa have I often been.
Know you one Vincenzio?
A merchant of incomparable wealth.
He is my father, sir, and sooth to say, in countenance somewhat doth resemble you. To save your life in this extremity, this favor I will do you for his sake, that you are like to Sir Vincenzio. His name and credit shall you undertake. If this be courtesy, sir, accept of it.
Oh, sir, I do, and will repute you ever the patron of my life and liberty.
Then go with me to make the matter good, to pass assurance of a dower in marriage betwixt me and Baptista's daughter here. In all these circumstances, I'll instruct you. Go with me to clothe you as becomes you.
Act 4, Scene 3. A room in Petruchio's house. Enter Caterina and Grumio.
No, no, forsooth, I dare not for my life.
The more my wrong, the more his spite appears. What, did he marry me to famish me? Am starved for meat, giddy for lack of sleep, with oath kept waking, with brawling fed, and that which spites me more than all these wants, he does it under name of perfect love. I prithee, go and get me some repast, I care not what, so be it wholesome food.
How say you? To a fat tripe finely broiled.
I like it well, good Grumio. Fetch it me.
Oh, I cannot tell. I fear 'tis choleric.
What say you to a piece of beef and mustard?
A dish that I do love to feed upon.
Aye, but the mustard's too hot a little.
Why then, the beef, and let the mustard rest.
Nay then, I will not. You shall have the mustard.
Then both, or one, or anything thou wilt.
Why then, the mustard without the beef?
Go! Get thee gone, thou false, deluding slave, that feedest me with the very name of meat.
Enter Petruchio and Hortensio with meat.
How fares my Kate?
Mistress, what cheer?
Faith, as cold as can be.
All here, love. Thou seest how diligent I am to dress thy meat myself and bring it thee. This kindness merits thanks. What? Not a word? Here, take away this dish.
I pray you let it stand.
The poorest service is repaid with thanks, and so shall mine, before you touch the meat.
Senor Petruchio, fie! You are to blame.
Eat it up all, Hortensio, if thou lovest me. Will we return unto thy father's house and revel it as bravely as the best with silken coats and caps and golden rings? Enter tailor and haberdasher. What news with you, sir?
Here is the cap your worship did bespeak.
Why, 'tis a cockle or a baby's cap. Away with it. Come, let me have a bigger.
I'll have no bigger. This doth fit the time, and gentlewomen wear such caps as these.
When you are gentle, you should have one too, and not till then.
Why, sir, I trust I may have leave to speak. My tongue will tell the anger of my heart, or else my heart concealing it will break. And rather than it shall, I will be free, even to the uttermost, as I please, in words.
I love thee well, in that thou likest it not.
Love me or love me not, I like the cap, and it I will have or I will have none.
Thy gown? Why, aye, come, tailor, let us see it. Why, what in devil's name, tailor, call thou this?
I see she's like to have neither cap nor gown.
You bid me make it orderly and well, according to the fashion and the time.
I did not bid you mar it to the time. I'll none of it. Hence, make your best of it.
I never saw a better fashioned gown, but like you mean to make a puppet of me.
Why, true. He means to make a puppet of thee.
She says your worship means to make a puppet of her.
Oh, monstrous arrogance. Thou liest, thou thread, thou thimble. I tell thee, aye, that thou hast marred her gown.
Your worship is deceived. The gown is made just as my master had direction. Grumio gave order how it should be done.
I gave him no order. I gave him the stuff.
But how did you desire it should be made?
Marry, sir, with needle and thread.
But did you not request to have it cut?
I say unto thee, I bid thy master cut out the gown, but I did not bid him cut it to pieces. Ergo, thou liest.
Why, here is the note of the fashion to testify. Imprimis, a loose-bodied gown.
Master, if I ever said loose-bodied gown, sew it me in the skirts of it and beat me to death.
Shh! Proceed.
With a small compassed cape.
I confess the cape.
With a trunk sleeve.
I confess two sleeves.
The sleeves curiously cut.
Aye! There's a villainy!
I commanded the sleeve should be cut out up and sewed again.
Hortensio, say thou wilt see the tailor paid. Go, take it hence. Be gone and say no more.
Tailor, I'll pay thee for thy gown tomorrow. Take no unkindness of his hasty words.
Well, come, my Kate. We will unto your father's, even in these honest, mean habiliments, to feast. I think 'tis now some 7 o'clock, and, well, we may come there by dinner time.
I dare assure you, sir, 'tis almost 2, and 'twill be supper time ere you come there.
It shall be 7 ere I go to horse. I will not go today, and ere I do, it shall be 1 o'clock I say it is.
Why, so this galleon will command the sun.
Act 4, Scene 4. Padua, before Baptista's house, enter Tronio and the pedant dressed like Vincenzio.
Sir, this is the house.
Signora Baptista may remember me.
'Tis well. And hold your own in any case with such austerity as longeth to a father.
Enter Baptista and Lucentio as cambio.
Here comes Baptista. Set your countenance, sir. Signora Baptista, you are happily met. Sir, this is the gentlewoman I told you of. I pray you stand good father to me now. Give me Bianca for my patrimony.
Soft son. Ma'am, by your leave, my son Lucentio made me acquainted with a weighty cause of love between your daughter and himself. And, for the good report I hear of you, I am content, in a good father's care, to have him matched. And if you please to like no worse than I, upon some agreement me shall you find ready and willing, with one consent to have her so bestowed.
Right true it is. Your son Lucentio here doth love my daughter, and she loveth him. And therefore, if you say no more than this, the match is made and all is done.
I thank you, madam. Where then do you know best we be affied and such agreement stand?
Not in my house, Lucentio. For you know, pitchers have ears and I have many servants.
Then at my lodging. And it like you, there doth my father lie. And there this night we'll pass the business privately and well. Send for your daughter by your servant here.
It likes me well, Gambio. Hi, you home? And bid Bianca make her ready straight. Lucentio's father has a right in Padua on how she'd likes to be Lucentio's wife.
Signora Baptista, shall I lead the way?
Enter Biondello.
Cambio, Baptista's daughter is to be brought by you to the supper. The old priest of St. Luke's Church is at your command at all hours.
She will be pleased. I'll roundly go about her. It shall go hard if Cambio go without her.
Act 4, Scene 5. A public road. Enter Petruchio, Caterina, Hortensio, and servants.
Good lord! How bright and goodly shines the moon.
The moon? The sun! It is not moonlight now.
I say it is the moon that shines so bright.
I know it is the sun that shines so bright.
It shall be moon or star or what I list. Or, ere I journey to your father's house.
Say as he says or we shall never go.
Forward, I pray, since we have come so far. And be it moon, or sun, or what you please, henceforth I vow it shall be so for me.
I say it is the moon.
I know it is the moon.
Nay, then you lie. It is the blessed sun.
Then God be blessed. It is the blessed sun. But sun it is not when you say it is not. But you will have it named even that it is, and so it shall be so for Caterina.
Petruchio, go thy ways. The field is won.
Well, forward, forward.
Well, Petruchio, this has put me in heart. Have to my widow, and if she be froward, then hast thou taught Hortensio to be untoward.
Exit Hortensio, and enter Vincentio.
Good morrow, gentle mistress. Where away? Oh, tell me, sweet Kate, and tell me truly, too, hast thou beheld a fresher gentlewoman?
Young, budding, virgin, fair and fresh and sweet, whither away or where is thy abode?
Why, how now, Kate? I hope thou art not mad. This is a man, old, wrinkled, faded, withered.
Pardon, old father, my mistaking eyes that have been so bedazzled with the sun.
Fair sir, and you, my merry mistress, my name is called Vincentio, my dwelling Pisa, and bound I am to Padua, there to visit a son of mine, which long I have not seen.
What is his name?
Lucentio, gentle sir.
Happily we met, the happier for thy son, and may entitle thee my loving father. The sister of my wife, this gentlewoman, thy son hath married. Wonder not, her dowry wealthy and of worthy birth. Let me embrace with old Vincentio.
But is it true? Or else is it your pleasure, like pleasant travelers, to break a jest upon the company you overtake?
Come, go along, and see the truth hereof.
End of Act 4. Act 5, Scene 1, Padua, before Lucentio's house. Enter Biondello, Lucentio, and Bianca.
Softly and swiftly, sir, for the priest is ready.
I fly, Biondello, but they may chance to need thee at home. Therefore leave us.
Exit Lucentio, Bianca, and Biondello. Enter Petruchio, Caterina, Vincentio, and Grumio.
Sir, here's the door. This is Lucentio's house.
What's he that knocks?
I pray you, tell Signor Lucentio that his father is come from Pisa, and is here at the door to speak with him.
Thou liest. His father is come from Padua, and is here looking out at the window.
Art thou his father?
Aye, sir, so his mother says, if I may believe her.
Why, how now, gentlemen? Why, this is flat knavery, to take upon you another man's name.
Lay hands on the villain.
Enter Biondello.
I have seen them in the church together. But who is here? My old master Vincentio. Oh, now we are undone.
Come hither, you rogue. What, have you forgot me?
Forgot you? No, sir, I could not forget you, for I never saw you before in all my life.
What, you notorious villain, didst thou never see thy master's father, Vincenzo?
Yes, marry, sir, see where he looks out of the window.
Is it so indeed?
Help, 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 here's a madman will murder me.
Prithee, Kate, let's stand aside and see the end of this controversy.
Enter Tronio, Baptista, and servants.
Sir, what are you that offer to beat my servant?
What am I, sir? Nay, what are you, sir? Oh, fine villain, a silken doublet. While I play the good husband at home, my son and my servant spend all at the university.
You mistake, sir. Pray, what do you think is his name?
I have brought him up ever since he was 3 years old, and his name is Tronio.
Away, away, mad ass. His name is Lucentio, and he is mine only son, and heir to the lands of me, Signor Vincenzio.
Lucentio! Oh, he hath murdered his master! Lay hold on him! I charge you in the Duke's name! Oh, my son! Tell me, thou villain, where is my son, Lucentio?
Go forth, an officer! Carry this mad knave to the goal!
Stay, he shall not go to prison.
Talk not, Signor Grimio. I say he shall go to prison.
Take heed, Signora Baptista, lest you be coney catched in this business. I dare swear this is the right Vincenzo.
Exit Tronio, and pedant as fast as may be. Re-enter Lucentio and Bianca.
Pardon, sweet father.
Lives, my sweet son?
Pardon, dear mother.
How hast thou offended? Where is Lucentio?
Here's Lucentio, right son to the right Vincenzo, and have by marriage made thy daughter mine, while counterfeit supposes bleared thine eyne.
Where is that damned villain Tronio?
Why, tell me, this is not my Gambio.
Cambio is changed into Lucentio.
Love wrought these miracles. Bianca's love made me exchange my state with Tronio, and happily I have arrived at the last unto the wished haven of my bliss.
But do you hear, sir? Have you married my daughter without asking my goodwill?
Fear not, Baptista. We will content you. Go to, but I will in, to be revenged for this villainy.
And I to the sound, the depth of this knavery.
Exit Vincenzo and Baptista, as well as Lucentio and Bianca.
Husband, let's follow to see the end of this ado.
First, kiss me, Kate, and we will.
What? In the midst of the street?
What? Art thou ashamed of me?
No, sir. God forbid. But ashamed to kiss?
Why? Then let's home again.
Nay, I will give thee a kiss. Now pray thee, love, stay.
Is not this well? Come, my sweet Kate.
Act 5, Scene 2. Padua, Lucentio's house. Enter Baptista, Lucentio, Bianca, Petruchio, Caterina, Hortensio, and Widow. Also, Biondello brings in a banquet.
At last, though long, our jarring notes agree. My fair Bianca, bid our fair guests welcome. Brother Petruchio, sister Caterina, and thou, Hortensio, with thy loving widow, feast with the best, and welcome to my house. After our great good cheer, pray you, sit down.
Oh, nothing but sit and sit and eat and eat.
Padua affords this kindness, and Petruchio.
Padua affords nothing but what is kind.
For both our sakes, I would that word were true.
Now, for my life, Hortensio fears his widow.
Then never trust me if I be afeard.
I mean, Hortensio is afeard of you.
He that is giddy thinks the world turns around.
I pray you, tell me what you meant by that.
Your husband, being troubled with a shrew, measures my husband's sorrow by his woe. And now you know my meaning.
A very mean meaning.
Right. I mean you.
And I am mean, indeed, respecting you.
To her, Kate!
To her, widow!
100 marks, my Kate puts her down.
Head and butt. and hasty-witted body would say your head and butt were head and horn.
I, Mistress Bride, hath that awakened you?
Ugh.
Nay, that you shall not. Since you have begun, have at you for a bitter jest or two.
Huh, am I your bird? I mean to shift my bush and then pursue me as you draw your bow. Ugh.
Exit Bianca, Caterina, and Widow.
Now, in good sadness, Saint Petruchio, I think thou hast the veriest shoe of all.
Well, I say no. And therefore, for assurance, let's each one send unto his wife. And he whose wife is most obedient to come at first when he doth send for her shall win the wager which we will propose.
Content? What is the wager?
100 crowns.
Content?
A match! 'Tis done!
Who shall begin?
That will I. Go, Biondello, bid your mistress come to me.
I go.
Son, I'll be your half. Bianca comes.
I'll have no half. How now? What news?
Sir, my mistress sends you word that she is busy, and she cannot come.
Is that an answer?
Sir Biondello, go and entreat my wife, and to come to me forthwith.
Oh, entreat her! Nay, then, she must needs come.
Do what you can. Yours will not be entreated. Now, where is my wife?
She says you have some goodly jest in hand. She will not come, she bids you come to her.
Worse and worse. She will not come. Sirrah Biondello, go to my mistress. Say, I command her to come to me.
Oh, she will not.
The fouler fortune mine, and there an end.
Now, by my holidame, here's Caterina.
What is your will, sir, that you send for me?
Where is your sister and Hortensio's wife?
They sit conferring by the parlor fire.
Go fetch them hither. If they deny to come, swinge me them soundly forth unto their husbands.
Here is a wonder, if you talk of wonder.
And so it is. I wonder what it bodes.
Mary, peace it bodes, and love, and a quiet life.
Now, fare before the good Petruchio. The wager thou hast won, and I will add unto their loss 20,000 crowns, for she is changed as she has never been.
Nay, I will win my wager better yet, and show more sign of her obedience. See where she comes, and brings your froward wives. Re-enter Caterina, with Bianca and Widow. Caterina, that cap of yours becomes you not. Off with that bauble, throw it underfoot.
Lord, let me never have a cause to sigh till I be brought to such a silly pass.
Fie. What a foolish duty call you this?
I would your duty were as foolish too. The wisdom of your duty, fair Bianca, hath cost me 100 crowns since supper time.
The more fool you for laying on my duty.
Caterina, I charge thee, tell these headstrong women what duty they do owe their lords and husbands.
Come, come, you're mocking. We will have no telling.
Fie, fie, unknit that threatening, unkind brow, and dart not scornful glances from those eyes to wound thy lord, thy king, thy governor. A woman moved is like a fountain troubled, muddy, ill-seeming, thick, bereft of beauty. Thy husband is thy lord, thy life, thy keeper, thy head, thy sovereign, one that cares for thee, and for thy maintenance commits his body to painful labor, both by sea and land, whilst thou liest warm at home, secure and safe, and craves no other tribute at thy hands but love, fair looks, and true obedience. Too little payment for so great a debt. I am ashamed that women are so simple to offer war where they should kneel for peace, or seek for rule, supremacy, and sway, when they are bound to serve, love, and obey. Why are our bodies soft and weak and smooth, unapt to toil and trouble in the world, but that our soft conditions and our hearts should well agree with our external parts? Come, come, you froward and unable worms. My mind hath been as big as one of yours, but now I see our lances are but straws. Then veil your stomachs, for it is no boot, and place your hands below your husband's foot, in token of which duty, if he please. My hand is ready. May it do him ease.
Why, there's a wench. Come on, and kiss me, Kate.
Well, go thy ways, old lad, for thou shalt have it.
'Tis a good hearing when children are toward.
But a harsh hearing when women are froward.
Come, Kate, we'll to bed. We three are married, but you two are sped. 'Twas I won the wager, though you hit the white. And being a winner, God give you a good night.
End of Taming of the Shrew.